Ross Edgley here, and these are my top five worst injuries from ultramarathon swimming. Coming in at number five, it's got to be jellyfish. Now, this will surprise a few people because obviously they do not tickle when they land on your face. But when swimming around the coast of Great Britain, there's nothing really that's really, really dangerous. It's not like Australia, the really, really bad ones. Really, you just get like the lion's mane, the ones in Scotland, and they sting. And I think what's worse than that is during a single tide, I think my record was something like 12 stings to the face. And what started to happen then, as the toxins seeped into my body, it started to attack my lymph nodes. So I was kind of like scratching under my armpits, my groin. That wasn't pleasant, but again, it wasn't fatal. So that's why jellyfish, number five. Number four, cellulitis. So I got this in Scotland after 53 hours in Loch Ness. And essentially what happened is the chafing got so bad, and then there was a bacterial infection in the water in Loch Ness and got into the skin. And the skin, oh, for want of a better term, it kind of starts to rot a little bit. Can be fatal if it gets into your bloodstream or your lymph nodes. So that's why that beats jellyfish coming in at number four. Also as well, kind of like an honorable mention when it comes to sort of skin and chafing is my tongue, salt tongue specifically. Again, swimming around Great Britain, 1,780 miles, 157 days. It was like I just licked a desert. Like my tongue hated the salt water. And what was so interesting is at the start, I loved granola, yogurt and granola. It was amazing. It was one of my favorite things to have for breakfast. But when your tongue is falling apart, it's just like basically chewing on sandpaper. My tongue was so raw, so I couldn't have granola anymore. And instead I ended up having like baby food and bananas. They were my savior, and just like mushed up food because my tongue had taken such a battering. So coming in at number four, cellulitis, chafing, in brackets, salt tongue. At number three, we have hypothermia. Obviously, after 53 hours in Loch Ness, my body didn't love me. And hypothermia just means that your body is unable to generate enough heat. You're losing more body heat than you can generate. Obviously, being cold to that extent wasn't pleasant, but I think what was also weirder was the hallucinations, because hypothermia mixed with a bit of sleep deprivation, your mind goes to some crazy places. So this is a bit of a weird story, but when we were in Loch Ness, obviously it's a really narrow pool of water. And I remember looking over the side and it's just surrounded by trees. And it was about 2 o'clock in the morning and these trees just formed this silhouette. And as I looked at the trees, it kind of looked like the silhouette of the Titanic or a massive cruise ship. I remember looking over, and then it got even weirder because with the trees, the branches just started to sway and it looked like people were waving to me. I was convinced that a cruise ship had turned up into Loch Ness to support me. So it's 2 o'clock in the morning. I'm turning to the trees and I'm saying, guys, thank you so much. The support means so much, especially at 2 o'clock in the morning for you to come out and be here with me. Truly, it means a lot. And at this point, my girlfriend, my brother, my mum are like, oh, he's talking to the trees. And even when I was in hospital, I was convinced that the cruise ship had turned up. I said, please make sure you thank everybody on the cruise ship. It wasn't a cruise ship, it was some trees. But hypothermia, yeah. Your body and your mind will go to some weird places. Number two, hypothermia. So this is basically heat stroke. And what was happening is in Tresemino, we basically set off in what was an anticyclone sent from the Sahara Desert. It was crazy. On the boat, I think one of the temperatures we recorded was 50 degrees. Considering saunas, infrared saunas are about 60 degrees, that kind of gives you an idea of just how hot it was. Ger Kennedy, absolute legend, open water swimming beast, ice swimming, just hero. I love that he had this saying. It was just like, Ross is cooking his potatoes. And I genuinely was. It was so hot. Weirdly, I'd rather be too cold than too hot. And what happened is, as I got pulled out of the Tresemino swim, my body was just trying to dump heat. So it was really strange that although it was 50 degrees on the boat, I was pulled onto it and I was shivering. I felt freezing. And then even being pulled onto the beach afterwards, people were kind of looking like, why is he shivering? It's so warm. So it was a really weird feeling. My physiology just didn't quite know what was going on. It was a completely malfunctioning. So I think because of how weird it felt and how unnerving it was, hypothermia beats hypothermia comes in at number two. And number one, this is the winner. So this tops them all, hands down. There's not even a close second. And this is rhabdo. So this was in my blood. And it's so hard to explain because with the cellulitis, with my tongue falling off, you could see it. Whereas with my blood basically just being boiled, it was a fatigue that I cannot explain and I never want to experience ever again. But rather than me actually sitting here and trying to explain it to you, we actually took a video with the doctors afterwards and they do an amazing job of explaining what rhabdo is and just how bad it could have got had we not treated it at the time. Take a peek at this.
It's been a few days now after the swim. What I've done is I've got the absolute heroes from the blood lab, and now this is almost like a round table of just like medical and sports science genius. We're gonna see what went wrong, talk about blood results, and see where we go from here.
So one of the blood tests we've sort of talked about quite recently, especially after the race and with the blood test you have done at the hospital, was your creatine kinase, which is a blood test we use often, especially within athletes, that helps us determine a degree of, say, for example, muscle breakdown. And often people who have higher levels of muscle mass would have naturally higher levels of muscle breakdown. So I think a normal range for you would have been around 1,000, which is what we saw in your blood test. But I think interestingly, when we went to the hospital and were able to get the report of your most recent blood test, there was quite a big difference between what's normal for you and how things have significantly changed post-race. We can obviously see that your creatine kinase, or this blood test that measures sort of significant muscle breakdown, which can lead onto conditions like rhabdomyolysis, which we'll talk about, was sort of near enough 20,000. So you can imagine sort of a big jump from sort of anywhere between 700 and 1,000 to 20,000.
Probably to put that into perspective as well, like we see obviously strong men at the blood lab, we see kind of all different athletes that really put their body under a lot of stress. And a value of something like 20,000 is by far the highest we've seen before at the blood lab. So that really kind of puts it into context of what you've just put your body through under them really extreme conditions.
And even levels just above 5,000 is considered severe enough to warrant someone to come into hospital. And with a level of 20,000, even if your overall kidney function had been compensating well, anything within a few hours, that situation would have been a lot different. You could easily be in a stage where you're dealing with significant kidney failure, requiring sort of intensive care level support, and even beyond that, sort of requiring sort of hemodialysis or dialysis for blood. So something you want to avoid, obviously. It looks like your blood tests have improved. So I think the latest creatine kinase was sort of anyway just under 3,000, which is excellent. And we expect it to improve over the next coming days and weeks, and you should start to feel better. I think you mentioned about feeling quite exhausted afterwards, didn't you?
So often, certainly during the swim, I'm like, no, you're more powerful than your own mind allows you to believe.
Definitely.
You know, central governor theory. So when I'm tired, I'm like, ignore it, keep going. And then you keep going. But what's so interesting, especially towards the end, in my head, I was swimming like 3.5, like 4K an hour. In my head, I was like, no. And then looking at footage, I'm like, that's not swimming. it was horrendous.
It's that mismatch that was a bit of an indicator. It's a subtle one, but it's an indicator that heat-related illness is starting to kick in. You know,
so it does play with your head then?
It does. It's the first sign of exhaustion, really. And exhaustion's the early stages. It can lead on to heat stroke, which is quite a bit more severe. But it was one of those early signs where we were starting to think, maybe Ross is not quite coping with the heat anymore.
So again, in my head, I was almost trying to override all of this, like the 20,000 creatine kinase, rhabdo. I was just there going, no.
And as we're saying, this is the time to slow down.
Yeah.
What were you doing, Ross?
I'm trying to speed up, Tom.
You're putting the gas down.
I know.
We were actually trying to calculate what your nutritional requirements would be from a calorie perspective, let alone a carb and fat and sugar perspective. And in someone doing basic rudimentary swimming, just covering distance, no weather condition, we estimated almost 26,000 calories you would have needed.
And that's not assuming even considering the heat.
Who's sweating properly and who can breathe properly, let alone with the humidity you'd have to deal with, the thick, warm air that you've had to breathe in. That would have made it difficult for your body to oxygenate properly. And then again, your ability to sweat properly, you recovered in clay. And how do you, there's no easy equation for us to calculate every 30 minutes what your requirements were. So some of it was basic understanding with a little bit of guesswork and feeding off how you were feeling more that's than anything.
But that's what
I think
like.
It worked out quite well. And I mean, looking at the blood test, and we know that your creatine kinase was ridiculously high, but thankfully everything else seemed relatively okay. And I think that's very reassuring in that sense, that we weren't too far off what we were trying to do in terms of managing your electrolytes. And
maybe in
like
the
that.
Right conditions.
Yeah, maybe in the right conditions, you know, things would have turned
been
out
vastly
different.
If we'd have kept going, it's not dramatic to say, actually, you could have ended up with cardiac arrest. That's the ultimate here.
Oh, exactly.
Your heart stops and we have to get you out of the water.
It's difficult to predict, but if at the point at which you called it, as your creatine kinase was already around 20,000, it was difficult to say how long it had been up there, but the sun was on, it was only going to get warmer and it was only going to get more difficult. Yeah. The likelihood is that within time, as you would have suffered with a heat-related illness, you would have found it more difficult to maintain level of concentration, your hydration would have reduced. As a result, you would have peed less, your kidneys would have started to fail, your potassium would have started to rise. And then at that point, the window just becomes smaller and smaller to pick that chance. And then once your, specifically your potassium, your sodium, and your urea level start to rise, you're really in tiger territory and you don't have much leeway, unfortunately. Mm. And then you've got to assume that the logistics of the hospital is ready to support you, which, I mean, thankfully they were at this particular time. So it's having that appreciation for having an understanding of how close things were for you.
Mm.
Despite recovering reasonably well, things could have just been so much more different had we left it a few hours. And
but again, just to draw this back, creatine kinase, 1,000 is rhabdo territory, 5,000 is severe rhabdo. Yours was just over 19,000, nearly 20.
Yeah.
So well into severe rhabdo territory.
But my kidneys were helping with some of the hit?
Your kidneys definitely kept going.
Yeah,
but
definitely.
We also have to just think about this.
Winning kidneys.
You have to think.
Winning kidneys.
Ultimately, rhabdo, as Darwood was saying, that's the breakdown of your muscle. Muscles have got lots of stuff in it that you don't want out. It's got myoglobin, it's got uric acid, it's got phosphate, it's got creatine kinase, all of this stuff. You don't want that leaking out. And really, if your kidney can't deal with all that, that's when your kidney starts to get clogged up. That's when potassium levels start to rise, and that's when we get into danger zone.
Mm-hmm.
Again, as we were saying, if your potassium levels go too high, that's when you get to heart stopping time.
So there we have it. They are my top five worst injuries as an open water swimmer. But what I love is in this community, we've created just like a tribe of just like absolute beasts who really push the boundaries of their own sport or discipline. So I would love it if you can comment below. Let me know the worst injuries that you guys have had. I just want this to be the most gruesome comment section in the entirety of YouTube. That is the goal. I think it's fair to say, as we look at the world's longest swim this year, I don't want any of these. I don't want anything listed on this five. And I don't want any new ones to add to it either. This has been a pretty gruesome video. I hope you've liked it. If you have, like, subscribe, and we'll see you for some much prettier vlogs, hopefully in the future.